Good afternoon, students. So we are discussing third unit digital sensors. In the previous class, we have discussed about the position encoders, in which we have discussed the two types, those incremental as well as absolute position encoders. Now we are going to discuss about the variable frequency sensors. In this, we are having the four topics to be discussed. So today we'll discuss about the variable frequency sensors. So these sensors based on a resonant physical phenomena that produces an output frequency depends on a physical quantity of being measured, which affects the oscillation frequency. In the previous case, position encoders, directly the analog quantity is converted to digital, whereas this comes under second category. As already discussed, the digital sensors are having the two categories. The first category we have discussed about the encoders, where it produces a digital output corresponding to the analog input quantity. Whereas this second category in the digital sensors, that depends upon other physical phenomena whose output may be depending upon the physical quantity being measured. So in such category, we are having these variable frequency sensors. So these sensors based on resonant physical phenomena yield an output frequency that depends on a physical quantity of interest affecting the oscillation frequency. That means these variable frequency sensors depends upon some physical phenomena that produces some oscillations whose output frequency depends upon the quantity being measured. That may be a density, that may be pressure or any quantity being measured affecting the oscillating frequency. That means we are using some phenomena. For that phenomena, it produces oscillations. The oscillation frequency is depending upon the quantity being measured. So by using that principles, variable frequency sensors will work. So these type of sensors require the use of frequency counter in order to measure either the frequency or oscillation period. So whereas in the previous case it does not require, but in this case, as the output oscillation frequency depending upon the quantity being measured, we require the frequency counter that is used to measure the frequency of oscillations produced or time period of the oscillations. So as per our syllabus, the different variable frequency sensors to be discussed are quartz digital thermometer, vibrating cylinder sensors, saw sensors, digital flow meters. So in this session, I am going to concentrate on these two topics. In the next session, we will go for another two topics. So first, quartz digital thermometers. So what is thermometer? Already we have discussed about the RTD, resistance thermometer device, whose resistance is depending upon the temperature being measured, which is having some positive temperature coefficient of resistance. But here, it is not that thermometer, it is a quartz digital thermometer. So we have discussed about the quartz in case of piezoelectric material. Quartz is a natural crystal, which is having some piezoelectric effect property. When we are applying mechanical energy or some vibrations, or we are creating some amount of force that can generate some electrical signal. When you are applying the electrical signal, that will convert into some mechanical vibrations. So here I am calling it as quartz digital thermometer. Okay, this operation of this quartz digital thermometer is based on temperature coefficient of a piezoelectric quartz crystal. That means, what is the property of piezoelectric material? When you are applying some mechanical energy that is converted to electrical signal, the whose frequency of electrical signal is depending upon the input pressure or force applied. But in this case, here also it is going to convert into some electrical signal, but whose output is depending upon the temperature. So that is depending upon temperature coefficient. So already we have discussed about the RTD thermistors, where we have discussed about the temperature coefficient, whereas RTD is having positive temperature coefficient of resistors, thermistor is having negative temperature coefficient of resistors. In a similar way, these operations are the operation of quartz crystal thermometer based upon the temperature coefficient of piezoelectric crystal, piezo quartz crystal. Okay, so here also we are using a piezoelectric crystal, so that is subjected to some temperature. When as the temperature of the crystal is changing, it is going to produce some electrical signal. So the frequency of electrical output is depending upon the amount of temperature. So this quartz thermometer is a high precision, high accuracy temperature sensor. It measures the temperature by measuring the frequency of quartz crystal oscillator. So as already told, the quartz crystal oscillator is able to produce some electrical signal whose frequency is depending upon the temperature being applied. So by using this, we can measure the temperature by measuring the frequency of quartz crystal oscillator. This quartz crystal possesses a property that its resonant frequency changes with change in temperature. So the resonant frequency of output changes with change in temperature. What is the resonant frequency? That is the maximum frequency of the oscillations. So that is changes with change in temperature. So I think you know about the resonance condition. In networks you have discussed about the resonance. Okay, in the output we are going to produce some amount of oscillations, in that the resonant frequency changes with change in temperature. So this property is made use of in quartz crystal thermometer for measurement of temperature. And as already we have discussed piezoelectric crystal, maybe it is a piezoelectric crystal, if you are applying some mechanical dimensions or changing dimensions, it will produce some output, electrical signal. So if this crystal is given a proper angle cut, if you are able to cut like this with some proper angle, there exists a linear relationship exists between frequency and temperature. So as per the requirement in the industry, they are going to properly cut the axis of this particular quartz crystal. Then if they are cut the properly, then there exists a relationship between, linear relationship exists between the resonant frequencies of output and temperature. So therefore, the resonant frequency is a measure of temperature. So the frequency is measured with the help of some digital frequency meters or frequency counters, and that is displayed. So whatever the frequency is measured, that is proportional to the temperature. So therefore, the output of the frequency meter is maybe directly calibrated in terms of temperature. So as already know that the crystal, quartz crystal, we can say that it is an oscillator. That oscillator contains a specially cut crystal, as I discussed, that results in a linear temperature coefficient of frequency. So the measurement of temperature is reduced to measurement of oscillator frequency. So we cannot, as already told, the temperature cannot be measured directly. Always the temperature can be measured indirect method only. That may be RTD, that may be thermometer, that may be thermistor, thermocouple, pyrometer. If you go for anywhere or any method, that is indirect method. So here also it is an indirect method. So simply this contains a quartz crystal, a cut crystal, which is having a linear temperature coefficient of frequency. So the measurement is taken care by measuring the oscillation frequency. So here we are going to get the best resolution. So almost 0.001 degree centigrade resolution is produced, and accuracy of almost 0.02 degree centigrade. Between the range 0 to 100 degrees centigrade are achievable. Same thing, this also explains same thing. So the advantage is it is having highly linear output, almost a small linear error of plus or minus 0.5% of full scale. It is having long-term stability and reliability. It is having high resolution of order of 0.001 degree centigrade. Here it is having excellent repeatability, almost considered precision, in the range of minus 40 degree centigrade to 230 degree centigrade. But limitations are, it has a low temperature range, whereas if you go for thermometer RTD up to 600 degree centigrade, we can go, or we can use thermocouple, maybe 2000 degree centigrade, above 1000 degree centigrade we can measure. But here it is having low temperature range. Crystal has strong cross sensitivity for pressure change. Even though we are going to measure the temperature, because of some external pressure changes, that is also undergo some change in sensitivity. Okay, so that pressure may affect the sensitivity. That is also a disadvantage of this variable frequency, sorry, quartz digital thermometer. So next topic of this variable frequency sensor is vibrating cylinder sensors. So generally, these vibrating cylinder sensors are used for measurement of pressure. So actually, before going to understand the principle of operation and construction of vibrating cylinder sensors, first we will understand the concept by seeing a vibrating wire gauges. Here if you observe, so this is a wire, or I can say that a strain gauge or any wire. So that is having some two supports. One support is some movable, and here I am having some electromagnetic coil, and this is a oscillator and amplifier. So this is actually bidirectional, that can produce the some electromagnetic energy to produce some vibrations, as well as it is going to pick up the voltage. Okay, now we'll see the transverse vibration is exerted by current pulses applied to this coil. So this oscillator applies some current. So due to this one, there are some transverse vibration of the wire is taking place. And while it is vibrating in the electromagnetic field, it can produce some electrical signal. So whose frequency of that electrical signal is depending upon the some external force or displacement applied to the wire. Say here I am having a fixed position, here I am having mobile position, here I am having some wire. Here I am going to energize this wire with some electromagnetic coil. When this wire is excited by the electromagnetic coil, it can produce some vibrations under with some small displacement. Okay, so while it is vibrating nearby this electromagnetic coil, the electromagnetic coil picks up the electrical signal. So the vibration can be converted into electrical signal, and the frequency of that electrical signal is depending upon the displacement applied. So it is, for the same current with some small displacement, it is having some vibrations. If you are elongating that wire, then also vibration will be produced, but that are having some different vibrations. That may be more vibrations or less vibrations depending upon the material used. Okay, so therefore, as the vibration changes, the output frequency of the voltage is changing. So that means the output voltage is depending upon the applied force or displacement. So like that, by measuring the frequency, we can estimate the what is the force or displacement applied to this wire. This is the same explanation for this diagram. If the position of one of the ends changes because it is mounted on a movable support, the oscillation period is directly proportional to the displacement applied. Or if a force is also applied, the resulting oscillation frequency is directly proportional. And the oscillation frequency is measured with a variable reluctance sensor. This is called as variable reluctance sensor, and falls within the audible range. And it is also called as acoustic gauge. The same device is also called as acoustic. Why? Because the frequency of output is that fall in the audible range. Okay. So actually, whatever the output producing because of this vibrating strain gauge, that oscillations is given by, the frequency of oscillation is given by 1 by 2L into f by m square root of 1 by 2, that is r square root of f by m, 1 by 2 l square root of f by m, where this l is the length of that strain gauge wire, f is the mechanical force applied to it, or because of the displacement also some force is applied, so that is f, m is the mass per length, that is mass density, longitudinal, it is called as longitudinal lateral. Longitudinal means that is diametrical. Sorry, longitudinal means lengthwise. Lateral is diameter. So longitudinal mass per length, that is m. So if you observe this concept or this frequency, that means the frequency of oscillation produced by this reluctance sensor is depending upon the vibrations of this particular one wire, which is depending upon the force applied at one end. So if you observe that equation, L is the length of the wire, that is constant. This mass density is also constant, M. So that is directly depending upon the F force applied. That means if you are able to measure the frequency, we can estimate the what is the amount of force applied to that particular wire. So this is another diagram, same almost. So this is the tensioned wire which is supported with the two ends. Here I am having electromagnetic coil. This electromagnetic is having two functions that can send the electromagnetic energy by flowing the current. Because of that, the tensioned wire will provide some vibrations, if you observe this one, vibrations. And also this is acting as a pickup coil, sensing coil. If you observe this one, input pulse line and output. From the same wires, we are having the two operations. It can send the input train of pulse and it can send the output signal. Okay. So when it is excited by some pulse, it will be vibrated, and because of the vibrations, the output signal will be changing. So the frequency, the output signal frequency is depending upon the force applied to this particular wire. So generally, a self-oscillated system is arranged where the detector output signal is amplified and fed back to an electromagnetic driver. So that is about vibrating wire. But further, after some research has been done, it has proposed that it is convenient to use a thin wire which is enclosed in a sealed chamber to avoid chemical corrosion and dust deposition, which would alter its mass. So if you are using this type of arrangement, there is a chance of it is exposed to the environment, there is a chance of corrosion for this particular wire. Okay, some dust may deposit on this one, the dust particles may change the mass position, so that may change the vibration position. So that's why it is convenient, or it is better, to use a thin wire enclosed in some sealed chamber. Okay, that we will see actually in the vibrating cylinder type. So by using this principle, it is possible to measure any physical quantity which results in change in L, F or M, that is the length, force or mass. Of all these applications, very common one is strain measurement. Okay, so the previous case we are using the vibrating wire. So instead of vibrating wire, if you use a thin, very small, almost 75 microns walled cylinder with a closed end, then oscillations of the frequency depends on dimensions and materials for cylinder and on any mass vibrating together with its walls. We'll see that arrangement also. So here also, by using an electromagnetic driver, electromagnetic coil to keep the system oscillating, it is possible to measure the difference in pressure between both cylinder sides, because it results in mechanical stresses in its walls. Because of the electromagnetic energy produced between the two ends of that cylinder, there is change in stress. So by using that, we can also measure the pressure difference. And also, this method is used for gas density measurement, because gas near the walls of the vibrating cylinder that vibrates when the walls For carousel liquids, it is better to use a glass or ceramic cylinder and a piezoelectric driver. So the most common application of this vibration cylinder type is measurement of density of flowing fluids. So whenever you want to measure the density of a liquid which is flowing through some pipe, then this method can be used. So we have to make arrangement such that flowing liquid is made to flow through this vibrating cylinder. So this is a vibrating cylinder. This enclosed chamber. So this enclosed chamber on which we are having the tube. So here we are having same electromagnetic driver as well as detector. So this is a support for this vibrating cylinder. So the liquid which is whose flow is to be measured is allowed to flow through this one, and it is. So these thin walls of the cylinder, when excited with electromagnetic coil, they can vibrate. So the amount of vibration is depending upon the density of the liquid flowing through this particular cylinder. So it consists of two parallel conduits through which liquid flows. Conduits means there is a way, or that may be you can say that there is a pipes, two parallel pipes like this, through which flow conducts. So two parallel conduits through which liquid flows. The two tubes are clamped to their ends and coupled to the main conduit by a flexible joint. So here we have some flexible joint. The both are joined here they are coming, and here they are separating. These are having the two parallel paths, and here they are joined. So because the volume of the liquid which is flowing through that one is known already, and because oscillation frequency for both conduits depends on mass, therefore already volume is known, and the depending upon the mass. So the frequency will depend upon the density. So as the density changes, the mass per volume also changes. So the density is nothing but actual mass per volume. So that depends upon the mass. Volume is already known. For example, we are going to measure the density of a liquid whose volume is already known, and we need to measure the density. So here simply, once again listen, this electromagnetic coil. So this is a cylinder. When electromagnetic coil produces some electromagnetic energy, this vibrate cylinder walls, it can expose to that electromagnetic energy. Because of that, it can vibrate. Now I am allowing some amount of liquid whose density measured. So the amount of vibration produced by the cylinder where the liquid is flowing through these two conduits, so that is depending upon the mass and density of the liquid. So this coil is also acting as a detector that detects the output voltage. The frequency of the output voltage depending upon the vibration produced by the cylinder walls, which is depending upon the density of the liquid. So this is the vibrating tube method to measure the liquid density. So that's why it is called as vibrating cylinder sensors. Okay. So here also the frequency of the output voltage is given by F equal to F naught divided by 1 plus rho by, otherwise square root of 1 plus rho by rho naught, where F naught is the frequency of that conduit of that particular cylinder when there is no liquid. When no liquid is flowing through that one, whatever the amount of frequency, that is nothing but F naught. And rho naught is the constant that depends upon system geometry, and where rho is the liquid frequency to be measured. So that means if you are able to measure the frequency, that directly gives the value of rho. As this is constant and rho naught is also constant, so the frequency of output voltage depending upon the. So the output frequency can be measured with a PLL whose VCO drives the vibrate tube. So this is the signal condition part. So I think the next semester you are having some LICA subject where you can discuss. PLL means phase lock loop whose VCO, voltage control oscillator. Here it is not required, the signal condition part. Simply you have to remember that the frequency of the cylinder, vibrating cylinder, is depending upon the density of the liquid flowing through that two parallel conduits. So the actual that is depending upon F equal to F naught divided by square root of 1 plus rho by rho naught, where F naught is the frequency of the conduits when there is no liquid flowing, and rho naught is the constant that depends upon the geometry of the complete system. So with this we are able to measure the frequency. If you observe these two topics, that is quartz digital thermometers as well as this vibrating cylinder, are coming two topics also, that is saw sensors and digital flow meter. So here we are using a phenomena which produces some oscillations. Here directly we are not converting the quantity being measured into digital. So yes, intermediately we are using the physical phenomena that produces some oscillations, whose frequency of oscillations is affected by input quantity being measured. Okay, is it clear? So like that we are able to measure the unknown quantity by using this variable frequency sensors. These are used for, actually these vibrating cylinders are used for measurement of pressure difference, and they are used for, most of the time this can be used for what you call as density. Okay, so whereas the previous these are used for measurement of strain also. Okay, so quartz thermometer is used for measurement of temperature based upon the temperature coefficient of piezoelectric property. Okay, so with this I am going to conclude the class. So next session we will discuss about the two topics, saw sensors and digital flow meters.